Hello everyone, and welcome back to our character creator series in Godot 4. In the previous part, we created our main scene and we imported our assets and project settings. Now in this video, we will create the base for our player, which is the actual character that we will move around the scene. So let's open up our project, and at the top, let's create a new scene. This new scene should have a character body 2D node as its root node. This node will allow our body to execute physics so that it can move around the map. Rename this node to Player and save the scene to your Scenes folder. Attach a script to the root node of the scene and save this script in your Scripts folder. You'll see that we have a little warning sign next to our character body 2D node. This is because we need to add a collision shape 2D node to our scene. We'll give this collision shape a simple circle shape collision, which will allow us to interact with items and be blocked by other physics bodies, and it will take the yellow warning away. To the scene, we'll also add a camera 2D node. We are going to add a camera to our scene so that we can focus on and follow our player around. We'll change the zoom value in the inspector panel to a higher value, such as 3, because we want to be pretty close to our player. Now, we'll have to create the skeleton for our player. Our skeleton will comprise of the different body parts of our player, so our body, our hair, our outfit, and our accessory. Each of these parts should be separate from one another so that we can easily manipulate its appearance, visibility, and color. This means that our player can have different to no hair, outfits, and accessories. Let's add another node 2D node to our scene. This node 2D node will contain and organize all of our skeleton parts, so we'll also rename this node 2D node to Skeleton. Now, for each part in our skeleton, so our body, our hair, our outfit, and our accessories, we'll add a Sprite2D node to our created skeleton. We're using a static Sprite2D node because we want to change its texture property in our character creator to reflect the features that we want. We'll then later on animate these individual Sprite2D nodes with an animation player node, which will allow us to animate the different parts of our body irregardless of the texture that is assigned to our Sprite2D node. So you'll see how that works in a bit. I don't want to confuse you because I know I am. So for now, let's just add our Sprite2D nodes and you'll see how this all works in the future. If you have more sprite sheets, say eyes, shoes, shirts, and pants, you will add these features as separate Sprite2D nodes. We only have sprite sheets for our player's body, hair, outfit, and accessories, so that's why we only have 4 Sprite2D nodes. But if you have sprite sheets that have a lot more features for a whole body, you will add them here. Now let's rename each of these parts to reflect the type of feature that this Sprite2D node will change in our player. Also add a label node to your skeleton. Now this label node is for testing only, since we are also going to give our player a name, and we'll use this label to see whether or not our player's name is actually setting and being changed. Also rename this label node to name. Now, to each Sprite2D node, we'll need to add a default sprite sheet to each of these Sprite2D nodes' texture properties in the inspector panel, so that we can crop out the individual frames of our sprite sheet. This will help us to not only focus on an individual frame to see if our sprite is displaying our set option, aka our chosen body, hair, outfit, and accessory, but it will also help us later on when we want to create our animations for our player. If you look at your assets folder, you'll see that there are a few sprite sheets for each of our skeleton parts. There is only one for our body sprite sheet because I only had one body in the free asset pack, but if you have different bodies, say like a female body, we would add it here. Let's open up two sprite sheets for our accessories. You will see here that you have two different hats. Now I want you to take note of the frame count horizontally and vertically on each of these sprite sheets. On each of these sprite sheets, you will see that you have exactly 8 frames horizontally and vertically. You will also see that both of these sprite sheets are the same size, which is 32 by 32. Let's see if this is the same for our outfits. Let's open up two random outfit sprite sheets, and you will notice the same thing. Now this is important because later on when we add animations, we'll need a consistent grid that will play the animation regardless of which specific feature is chosen, because all features follow the same layout in their sprite sheets. So if you are making your own system later on with your own sprite sheets, make sure that all of your sprite sheets follow the same layout and all of them have the exact same size. If you can't have, for example, your body and accessory sprite sheets to have the same layout, make sure that at least all of your accessory sprite sheets are the same. All sprite sheets of the same feature has to be the same. That is the rule. So let's get back to adding a default sprite sheet to each of our skeleton parts and then cropping them out. Select your body node and drag your only body sprite sheet into the texture property. For this sprite sheet, we counted 8 frames horizontally and vertically, so we'll crop out our frames with these values. Now, select your hair node and drag the first hair sprite sheet into the texture property. Also crop it out at 8 frames because it has 8 frames horizontally and vertically. Select your outfit node and do the same. Do the same for your accessory node. And here we have the base setup for our player skeleton. We might also want to add some text to our name and move our label above our player's head. Okay, so let's add some movement code to our player. Now we're not going to animate our player yet because we still need to create our character creator, which will add features to our player. So for now, we're just going to add some basic movement to our players so that we can move them left, right, up, and down. Open up your player script and let's clear the existing code. We'll have to create two new variables that will store our player's direction and speed. Now in our physics process function, we can update this last direction variable based on our movement input. This physics process function is called every physics frame, which is separate from the rendering frames. So it's typically where you handle physics related updates. Within this function, we will create a new variable, which will store our direction as a vector2 object. This direction will change on the x and y axes depending on our input. So if we press left, the x axis value will go below 0. If we go right, the x axis value will go above 0. If we press up and down, the y axis value will also change respectively. If you're unsure, the UI left, UI right, UI up, and UI down are inputs that's already defined by Godot in our project settings. It adds access inputs to our up, down, left, and right arrow keys on our keyboard. We'll then use this direction to set our player's velocity, which will move the player in that direction at the speed that we set for our player. Finally, to move our player, we'll need to call the move and slide method to actually execute the physics on our body. This will move our player in the determined velocity based on our input. To see if our player is moving around the screen, we'll have to temporarily disable our camera. So make sure that your camera is disabled in the inspector panel. Back in our main scene, let's instance our player scene. Make sure to drag your player to the middle of the border in your screen so that we can actually see the player. If you run your scene now, your player should move in the press direction. And that is it for this video. In the next part, we will create our global script, which will store all of our feature values. That's it for me. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next one.